Okay.
Just saw some pictures. I'm going to give a brief testimony.
Good.
Saw some of those pictures and brought me back. It was 1996. It was summertime. I can't remember the exact day. I asked, there's a gentleman, his name is Sam. I asked him, I said, yeah, do you remember what day it was? And they couldn't remember, so that's fine. But I remember it was in 1996, the summer of 96. And my brother, I had approached my brother and I told him, you know, because I was going to a Trinitarian church at the time, and I said, you know, I need to be, you know, I understood the revelation of being baptized in Jesus' name in Acts 2:38. And I understood the name of Jesus and the power in that. So I went up to my brother, and I remember, I thought, well, you know, I'm going to go ahead and tell him. So I said, hey, I want to be baptized in Jesus' name. And my brother said, you're going to get baptized again? He got mad at me. He said, you're wrong. You're going to get lost. God's going to punish you. You're going to get in trouble, you know. And I said, well, the Bible says you need to do it this way. And so even though he yelled at me, I left by myself. I went in, and so I went into a church where everyone was excited that I was getting baptized in Jesus' name. I got baptized, and I felt a big difference after I came out of the water and understood that there was a difference. Because those that are baptized and under the Trinitarian faith, that they don't feel anything when they come out. It's when they do it in the name of Jesus, even though it's in the same place and you're still getting submerged, just that name will change it. So I understood that there's power in the name. So I'm glad to be saved. It's I believe in one God. It's exciting. Because I met him, and he taught me the revelation, and I'm just glad to be back in depth class, and we're ready to start here. Mm-hmm. Pray for Gabe. Gabe's in the hospital right now.
Oh.
You can't see what she's saying.
What's his name?
Gabe?
The older gentleman that
he had a pain in his stomach.
Oh, okay. All right, so we're gonna pray. Let's go ahead and pray. God, I pray for Gabe. He's sick. He's in the hospital right now. God, I pray that you would heal him, God. And I pray that that you would anoint Brother Nolan. Give him your word. I'm ready to learn. I'm ready to receive your word. We're all excited to hear the word of God. And there's power in your name. In Jesus' name, amen.
So I had a picture. I wanted to say hello, but
there we go.
There we go. Thumbs up.
This is so fun. God is good, man.
Okay, so in my PowerPoint, I was getting it together, getting everything all dialed in, I looked at it, and there was something I was going to do a little bit later, and God has a reason why, so I'm going to put that PowerPoint that I was working on the side, and I was just thinking, talking about the power of Jesus' name?
Being baptized in Jesus' name,
and he just confirmed it. So in the book of Acts, and I'm going to explain, I have a point I'm going to get to a little bit later. The book of Acts is like, there's the four gospel writers, and then after it is Romans through to Revelations. But right smack in the middle is the book of Acts. And I want to see what they're doing in the book of Acts. And you know what the word apostle is. We have the 12 disciples, and they became 12 apostles. When Judas died, there was 11, and they picked a new one to make it 12. They picked Matthias. Is that his name? Matthias. So you know who wrote the book of Acts was Luke, right? And he wrote about what people were doing in that time. So they're writing what the apostles are doing in the book of Acts.
The Acts of the Apostles.
Uh-huh. So all the entire book is all of what they're doing, their acts. I'm going to follow along verse by, in this verse, you can follow along with me, Acts chapter 1, verse 4. Verse 4 says, and being assembled together with them, and remember, this is Paul writing that, this is right when they were talking with the 500 people that saw Jesus ascend, the ascension of Jesus. And later there was 120 people that stayed, that were stayed together. The rest of them had wandered off, they left. And the next verse goes on to say, commanded them, he commanded the 500, he commanded them that they should not depart, wanted them to stay in Jerusalem. That they should not depart from Jerusalem. That's another sign for Jerusalem.
J-City
or Jerusalem.
That's
because of Welling Wall. Okay. He said not to depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith ye that have heard of me. So he told them before this. He said, I want you all to wait for me and wait in Jerusalem. Don't depart. And if you look in Luke, Jesus is speaking to the group there that was there, and he was explaining in Luke chapter 24, verse 49. It says, and behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you. So if you hold on and wait, if you do, you're going to receive the promise. But tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem. So this one, this verse in Acts says, depart not. And this verse says, tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high. And this is the Holy Ghost, which you already know of that. He's talking about the Holy Ghost there. That's when they receive the Holy Ghost anew. So the word tarry means to wait, stay and wait. And Acts chapter 1, verse 8 says, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses. Notice it says, ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea, in Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the earth. And Acts chapter 2, verse 4, it says, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. I'm going to make the connections with all this a little bit later. In Acts chapter 2, verse 38, you know this verse well. This is Peter preaching right here. And then if you look at Acts chapter 2, verse 41, it says, then they that gladly received his word were baptized. And the same day, there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. It's 3,000 souls. And this is Jesus' name. It still continues today. So my topic for today is I refuse to stop preaching Jesus' name. And that's the only name that has power. Mm-hmm. I love His word. And again, in Acts chapter 3, verses 6 through 8, verse 6 says,
Give I
thee in the name of Jesus Christ. And if you notice in verse 7, he immediately received his healing. He was leaping and jumping. Now, we look at this. If you read all the way through, there's a whole lot more. There's so much more that was going on. But Luke just picked certain things to show.
Theophilus.
He just picked certain things of what happened and put it down in the Word.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, Peter and John were arrested. And they were thrown in jail. And that's, of course, sad. It's sad, but they praised the Lord while they were in there, right? That was Paul and Silas. Paul and Silas did that. So, do you know why they were arrested? Because they were preaching in Jesus' name. They were told to stop, and they didn't, so they were arrested. But, if you notice, today we have freedom to speak about anything. We're not going to be arrested. We could speak and we could preach the truth. If you notice, Acts chapter 4, verses 1 through 4, verse 1 says, as they spake unto the people, and they is referring to Peter and John, as they spake unto the people, the priests and the captain of the temple and the Sadducees, they believed in the first book.
The first five books.
They didn't believe that Jesus rose again. They did not believe that. So, all these people, they came unto them. Verse 2 says, being grieved that they taught the people and preached through Jesus the resurrection from the dead. So they were preaching in Jesus' name. There's power in that name. Verse 3 says, and they laid hands on them. That means they arrested them. They laid hands on them and put them in hold unto the next day. So why didn't the world is so blind to this? You notice here, he preached through Jesus. If they were preaching through the Father, they wouldn't have been arrested. But because they were using the name of Jesus, they were arrested. And the people were so blinded at that time, and they were angered. But there's power in the name of Jesus. It has a power for salvation. So it's very interesting. Amen. And they laid hands on them and put them in a hold until the next day, for it was now eventide. So it means they arrested them and put them during the evening and put them in jail. Howbeit, many of them which heard the word believed. So if you notice, many of them which heard the word, they believed it, which means they were baptized in Jesus' name already. They believed it. And the number of the men was about 5,000. So there's about 5,000 men that were baptized. So the priests and the temple of the guards, the Sadducees, they were all angered because they told them to stop preaching in Jesus' name. There is power in that name. Wow, this is awesome. Acts chapter 4, verses 5 through 7. If you notice, it says, and their rulers and elders and scribes and Ananias the high priest and Caiaphas and John and Alexander, as many as were the kindred of the high priest, that means they were a part of the group, they were gathered together at Jerusalem. In this next part, in verse 7, it says, why were they all gathered there? They had saw what had happened, and they knew all, everything that had happened up to that point, and they were angered that they continued to preach in Jesus' name. But we know the importance of the name of Jesus. There's power in that name. But they were angered by this, and they arrested them. And all these people were there at the time. But do you know why?
Because it was better to be involved than them.
And when they, which is all the high priest and all them, had set them in the midst. So they set them in the middle of the group. They asked them. Do you know what they asked? Maybe they wanted healing. Maybe there was some note or name. Maybe they need the Holy Ghost. Maybe they need salvation. Cast out some devils. They know that there's power in the name of Jesus. So when I read this, 5,000 souls, 5,000 souls were saved. They're just spreading from there. So when they sat them in the midst of them, they asked them, and they were not ashamed to answer and let them know. And they asked them, they said, by what power? And they asked them, by what power are you doing all these things? He asked them, by what power? By what power, or by what name? By what name have you done this? They wanted to know. They asked him. All these things that you're doing, what power, what name are you using? All these healings that are taking place, all these things that you're doing. So if you were to watch this up here in verse, this is pushing. There were the priests were there, Caiaphas was there, John, Alexander, and this here it says, as many as were of the kindred of the high priest. So that means all those that were affiliated with the high priest. That's when they arrested Peter and John, and they questioned them. All those men that were there, they questioned Peter and John. In Acts chapter 4, verse 12, these few verses here, 5, 6, 7, there's other verses there, but I'm skipping a few. I'm going on to verse 12, and there's more after this as well. But verse 12 says, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. And we all knew that, they all knew that there was only one name, the name of Jesus. And Acts chapter 4, verses 14 through 16. Mm-hmm. verse 14 says, and beholding the man which was healed, he was healed, standing with them, they could say nothing against it. They saw what had happened, they saw the healing, and they could not say anything. They could not disprove what they saw. Now, and we refuse to stop talking and preaching in the name of Jesus. The Bible says there's no healing in any other name. If you're sick, you must pray in the name of Jesus for your healing. There's only one name that you can use for your healing. Yes. Verse 14, 15 says, but when they had commanded them to go outside of the council, they went out from the group, and they conferred among themselves. What are we going to do with them? So they went outside, aside from the council, and they conferred among themselves, saying, what shall we do to these men? For that indeed, I mean, they're confessing that. He said, for indeed a notable miracle hath been done by them, is manifest to all them that dwell in Jerusalem, and we cannot deny it. We can't deny it. Verse 17. Verse 17 goes on to say, but that it spread no further among the people, let us straightly threaten them that they speak henceforth to no man in this name. So they told him to stop talking about the name of Jesus. If you look at back here to verse 18, 19, and 20, 18 says, and they called them and commanded them. He commanded them not to speak at all. I mean, they told him to just not to speak at all. They told him, no more. Do not speak anymore. Or teach. So they couldn't teach in that or speak in the name of Jesus. They told him. They saw the miracles. They saw that it happened. They saw all the many miracles that had happened in chapter verses 4 and in chapter 3, all the healing. Remember that man that was healed and was at the gate, sitting at the lame at the gate, and when he was healed, he saw everything that happened. And he commanded them not to speak or teach in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John answered and said unto them, whether it be right in the sight of God to hearken unto you more than to God? We can't pay attention to you and listen to you more than we listen to God. God judge us. For we cannot but speak the things which we have seen and heard. And then the next verse is Acts chapter 5, verse 40. Mm-hmm. And again, this is in chapter 5. It says, and to him they agreed. And when they had called the apostles and beaten them, they were beaten. They commanded that they should not speak in the name of Jesus. And then they let him go. Wow. That is very interesting. Wow. They were told to stop talking in the name of Jesus. They saw and everything that had happened, and they told him to stop talking about it. Stop preaching in the name of Jesus. They didn't want to hear about the name of Jesus any longer. And that was the priest, right? They were against the name of Jesus. They wanted them to stop talking about it. And Peter refused. He kept on preaching. That's interesting. Even when they were imprisoned and told to stop, they kept on. So many of the Trinitarians are blind to this issue. Mm-hmm. There's so much proof about one God. Wow. Amen. Acts chapter 4, verse 6. Oh, he passed it. 6. Yeah, so verse 6 was saying that Ananias, the high priest, and Caiaphas, and John, Alexander. So John and Alexander, they were there with them? Were they part of the high priests?
And as many of them were, he was still the high priest.
Yeah.
So they're affiliated with the high priest.
Yeah.
So I was wondering, at that time, Peter and John, when they were arrested, they had a private meeting amongst themselves as to what to do with Jesus. So was John there during that meeting when they were talking about this, or did they hear him? So they asked each other, what do we do with these two, right? That's a really good question that you had there. So this John right here, let's look at this verse again. As you see in verse 3, it says, and they laid hands on them. And this talk referring to Peter and John. They laid hands on them and put them in a hold. They didn't walk off. They were being held. He put them in a hold until the next day, for it was now eventide. So this was they arrest him in the evening. Howbeit, skip that verse. And in verse 6 again, it says that. Oh, actually, verse 5 says, and it came to pass on the morrow. That means the next day, that their rulers and elders and scribes, so there's a high priest, Caiaphas, John, Alexander, it's different.
It's not the John that was arrested.
Yes, it's a different John. But my question was, I was wondering if when the two were arrested and put in hold, could they hear what they were talking about? Or was that in a private meeting amongst themselves? Well, we do know that Luke was not there. He didn't meet with them and converse with them at that time.
He never met with Jesus.
Yeah, he never talked with Jesus.
He was writing these things to Theophilus. So Theophilus had heard what was going on. And so was sent as basically a writer and says, okay, I'm going to go. And so he writes the book of Luke about the life of Jesus, then decides to write about the apostles because he's following them along and seeing what they're doing, writes in details. And he does it via asking people. And he could have asked any one of these people in the story for the details of the story.
I was just wondering.
Who knows?
I was just wondering if they were there, if they heard what had happened.
Yeah.
It's possible. Maybe somebody told them. So as I was reading this, I was just wondering how they knew that they had a private meeting amongst themselves and all that. So if you look at this verse here, hold on just one moment, let me find it. It's possible that the gossip could have gotten through and they could have heard it and somebody gathered up all the information and as they wrote it down, but yeah, I don't know. I'm not sure. When we get to heaven, we'll have to ask them. So the group, maybe they were discussing a group, trying to figure out what to do. Maybe somebody, the gossip spread and somehow it got to them, but they heard what had happened. So if you look at the verse 7, it says, they're asking, they said, by what power or by what name have you done this? And that was, you know, there's other verses after this, verse 8 and on. So the verse that says, by what power or by what name? They're still doubting the name of Jesus. But even though they asked him, they still doubt. Right. They were trying to, they wanted the absolute power and control is what they were after. Okay. So I know this is a little bit short for this morning. It's 11:25, so I think we could maybe add something a little bit more, and then we could just briefly look at it, just about 20 minutes or so. And if we end in short enough time, we can go on to the next part that I want to
finish this one. I'm saying, yeah, this one was short, and
gonna add another short.
So we added a second, yeah.
Okay. Does anybody have any questions about this before we go on? So this the acts of the apostles. It means what they've done. Their acts.
So this is within the first 5 books. No. It's different. Yes, this is different. Saying, remember, there's a list that says the first 5 books. Right, that's the Pentateuch. Yeah, that's different. That's in the Old Testament.
They're using Jesus' name. This is what they're doing. They're baptizing people in Jesus' name and all the different things that they're doing in Jesus' name. This is their acts. So if you were to carefully read the book of Acts, if chapter 1, and Jesus was there in Acts chapter 1, and he was explaining to them what to do. And then when he ascended, and he told them to go and wait for the promise. And then after that, when the Holy Ghost was poured out, the church was established from that point on. So from chapters 2 to 28, we never find any other name that was used. There's no power in any other name, only in the name of Jesus. There is no other name that has the power. You can read everything carefully. It's only in the name of Jesus. They've done it all, baptizing in the name of Jesus. Not in the titles, just in Jesus' name. And if you have to go back to the beginning of the church and look to find it, to really get it. So the death, burial, and the resurrection, there's power in that name. So if you take away the name, it's like you're denying his resurrection. And Acts chapter 28, it doesn't end. The last book of Acts does not end. It is still continuing unto this day. So today, maybe we're in the book of Acts chapter 513 or chapter 3, maybe in Brother Wilson's preaching about the Holy Ghost in there. Who knows? But the book of Acts is still going on today. It has not stopped. So I'm going to go ahead with my second. I went ahead and I did set up another second topic for today. I was planning to do more explanation, but I think I'm going to go ahead and go on with my next topic, which is in Galatians chapter 1, verse 6 through 10. This will be about maybe 10 minutes, if that's okay with you all.
Yeah.
And Paul wrote the book of Galatians.
Yeah.
And this is the name of, is that the city? Galatians?
Galatia.
Yeah. Oh. And the people, the S at the end just means the people in Galatia. Okay.
Galatians.
And Galatians chapter 1 verse 6. I marvel. So if you can imagine Peter and Paul, both of them coming together on a boat. Going off to preach and then coming back, and this was a long time ago, but just imagine both of them, they were standing up there.
If they were rise today.
Oh, if they rose today. If they came alive today, were resurrected from the dead today. All the things that we have now. Like they had a really long nap. But they were just, can you remember what? Going into other churches, they're like, right. Wait, that's not the truth. They would be shocked at the different churches that are out now. They would be looking for this church here. They would be looking for this one because we preach the same as what they did back in that day, in that time. There's a lot of people that change and twist the truth and twist the word a little bit, and that's not good. So, Paul said in verse 6, says, I marvel. It's like he's shocked. I marvel. I am shocked, surprised. I marvel that ye, and this is talking to the people of Galatia, people in that city, that's the people in that area. So is it talking to the church in that area? Yes. This is a letter written to the church at that time. That is correct. And Galatians, he wrote a letter and sent it to the city of Galatia. And he said, I marvel that ye are so soon. If you notice, these people were born again and they went right back out into the world. But he said, I marvel that ye are so soon removed from him that called you unto the grace of Christ unto another gospel. There is no other gospel. So if you look at verse 7, it says, which is not another. There is not. There's only one gospel. There's none other. You either have the gospel or you have nothing. So these people would have been baptized and then they switched to another belief, another different. Yeah. They said there's only one gospel, there's none other. So you know, a lot of people believe in the accepting Christ as our personal savior type thing. So this is just accepting. I'm talking about specifically in the book of Acts when the church was established from that point on. The accepting Christ as your personal savior, that stuff, that wasn't there after that point. You had to follow the gospel. You believe in the Lord as your personal savior type thing. That's another gospel. That is not what the gospel teaches. Verse 7 says, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you and would, what's this word here mean, pervert?
Change.
Deviate from the truth. Change. Or deviate from the truth.
Yeah.
So they turn aside and go to another gospel, another belief. He said, which would pervert the gospel of Christ. Verse 8 goes on to say, but though we, and this is Paul saying this, he said, but though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel. Notice it says any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, so this is he's referring to everything that he's preached up to this point. He preached all the Jesus' names of salvation. He said, if any come and preach unto you, let him be accursed. So there's either Jesus' name only or none other. So the titles of the Trinitarian, it's not there. There is no, you cannot be saved by the titles.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot receive the Holy Ghost through the titles. There's only one, and that's through the name of Jesus. A lot of people try hard to analyze this and prove that they're right, but they can never find it. There's only one, and that's the name of Jesus. I am not ashamed of the gospel. Verse 9 says, as we said before, so say I now again, if any man preach any other gospel, unto you, like that.
It's not
that, except when you're Christ, your personal savior, that's not in the Bible. It says, if any man preach any other gospel, unto you again, have received the Holy Ghost. If any man preach any other gospel unto you, than that ye have received, let him be accursed. And that's... And in verse 10 here, it says, for do I now persuade men? So, am I teaching trying to persuade men or God? Or do I seek to please men? So am I trying to switch the word of God just to make people happy? Maybe I notice something, I'm like, oh, I'm going to twist this around. I'm going to change it to make people a little more happy as I preach this. I'll lose my own self, and that's not worth it. I should not be, so if you notice this, if I do this, it says I should not be the servant of Christ. So again, it goes, if I were to pervert the word of God or twist it to please men, then I should not be the servant of Christ. A servant of Christ would do things in Jesus' name. They would not twist the gospel. So now I'm looking forward to next Sunday morning. I know I postponed this a little bit, but be patient. I'll have all the information. Maybe we'll have a little bit longer. Maybe it'll be a two-part Sunday for my next lesson. So if you have any questions, anybody have questions? So again, I want to take... So preaching it. In Jesus' name.
Operations.
I don't know.
Yeah.
Somebody else out there?
No.
Is that just
I feel like I heard another one.
Is that you?
I don't think so.
As it says here, when Paul said, I need my glasses. Oh, here it is in verse 7. Which is not another. So there's no other gospel. There is no other gospel. Accepting Christ, your first slave, or anything like that, that's another gospel. Yep. He said there is no other gospel, only this one.
I gave them homework. They get to look up the verses. Some of them I wrote. There's no way I could keep up with that. You went through a lot of verses. Not to mention I'm exhausted.
Whatever you get, it's fine.
What?
So whatever you get, it's fine. It should be good.
Like Jehovah's Witnesses, there's all a bunch of different gospels. That's not the church. If so, those other places are not the church. It's like a house of men. They set it up on their own. The church was born in the Bible, and it started in Jesus' name, and it's continued from that point on. It's not changed. I know there are people that are not baptized in Jesus' name. There are some people that don't know. So do you mind praying to close? This is good teaching. Wow. Did you guys benefit from his teaching? It's awesome. He's such a good teacher. There's only one way to be baptized, and that's in the name of Jesus. Amen. I'm so excited. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the teaching, and we benefit from hearing your word. In Jesus' name.